Yes, students, I am Sundarakrishnan. I am a chartered accountant cum company secretary. I work as a financial consultant, but in addition to that, I also take classes. I enjoy taking classes, that's why I take class. You can be very, very comfortable with me. Any questions you have, you can ask me. I'll be able to explain to you. Not a problem at all. Today, I am going to teach you about basic principles of a partnership firm with reference to the maintenance of accounts. See, if so far you must have studied accounts of a sole proprietor, that means there is only one proprietor who manages the entire business. But as the business grows, a sole proprietor would like to start off, take some more partners and make his firm as a partnership firm. Instead of there being one person managing the entire business, there will be two or three persons managing the business. The individually, these persons are called partners and they run the business normally under a name, and such name is called a firm's name. Firms means a group of partners. Partnership Act controls the functioning of partnership. See, this act is unique in itself. It is not like any other act. Normally, you cannot override the provisions of any other act. Act is supreme. Companies Act very specifically says, if there is a contradiction between the provisions of Companies Act and of Memorandum or Articles of Association, which are framed by the company, the provisions of the Companies Act are applicable. However, under the Partnership Act, every section virtually starts with the expression, unless otherwise agreed. Such and such things. In other words, you can agree. And if there is an agreement between the partners, that agreement is supreme. And the Partnership Act does not come in the way of the agreement. Only in the absence of either the partnership deed or the partnership deed is silent on a particular topic, the provisions of Partnership Act 1932 are applicable. This you have to remember it very clearly. Then, what is the definition of a partnership under a Partnership Act? It says the relation existing between people, the relation existing between people who have agreed to share the profits of the business carried on by all. Or any of them for all. Relation existing between persons who have agreed. Carried on by all or any of them for all. The relation existing between people who have agreed to share the profits of a business carried on by all or any of them acting for all. This definition, it brings out certain characteristics of partnership. What are those characteristics? The first is the plurality of the person. That means there has to be at least two persons in a partnership firm. You cannot have a partnership firm having only one person. There is a plurality of the person. There should be at least two persons. Immediately you might ask me, what should be the maximum? Yes. Partnership Act does not state the maximum number of persons. That is stated by the Companies Act. Section 11 of the Companies Act says a partnership firm cannot have more than 10 persons if it is carrying on the business of banking. Banking means both accepting of deposits and lending out of money. If it is carrying on any other business, the maximum number of partners can be 20. So in other words, if the partnership firm is carrying on the business of banking, the maximum number of partners can only be 10. And in all other cases, the maximum number of partners can be up to 20. Yes. So plurality of the person, that is the first characteristic of the partnership firm. The second is the existence of business. What for these people are joining together? To carry on a business. So the business could be a very simple grocery shop. They might buy items like rice, wheat, atta, maida, suji, various items for the purpose of selling and make profit out of it. It can be a small manufacturing unit. It can even be a Xerox shop where you install Xerox machines, and when a customer comes in, you take out Xerox copies, gives it to them. So, but there should be a business, and the coming together of these people is to carry on a business. If the people come together to do some charity work, it might be a partnership, but then the Partnership Act is not applicable. Okay, so the first characteristic is plurality of the person. The second one is the existence of business. The third characteristic is sharing of profit and losses. Again, the Partnership Act says, unless otherwise agreed, the partners are to share the profits and losses equally. You can have an agreement in the partnership deed saying the profits are to be shared. If there are three partners in the ratio of 3:2:1, then that provision will be applicable. But if the partnership deed is absolutely silent on the profit sharing ratio, or there is no partnership deed at all, it is not compulsory the partners have to have a partnership deed, but it is preferable to have it. So the profit sharing ratio will be equal. In a problem, in your examination, if the problem is silent regarding the profit sharing ratio, you have to assume it is equal. Even though one of the partners or one or more of the partners would have contributed more capital than the third partner, the profit sharing ratio will be equal. The fourth characteristic is the unlimited liability. What is an unlimited liability? Whole question arises, a person starts business. Okay, as long as the business earns profit, does well, and he is able to make profit, the firm is making profits, it's good. But assuming for a moment, the business starts incurring losses and he carries on the business for some time, it continuously keeps on incurring losses. So when that happens, what he will normally do is, what this person will do is, normally what he will do is, he will stop running the business. Then he will try to sell off the business assets and pay off the business creditors. That is the persons to whom the firm owes money. He starts paying that money. If the amount obtained by him by sale of the business assets are not sufficient to pay off the business liabilities, even his personal assets will be liable. He may have to sell some of his personal assets to pay off these liabilities. There is no distinction between business liability and personal liability because of the fact that the partnership firm has got an unlimited liability. The liability is not only unlimited, but it is also joint and several. What do you mean by joint and several? See, let us assume that three persons are carrying on the business. A, B, C, they are the partners. So, they carry on the business for some time, they start incurring losses. So, they decide to close down the business, sell off the assets and pay the liabilities, pay their obligation to various parties. Let us assume that the entire money that they got by selling of the assets was not sufficient to pay off the liabilities. The persons who have to still get the money from the firm can sue any of the individual partners separately, that is called severally, or he can sue all of them or some of them. If there is a A, B, C, he can sue A, he can B, sue B, he can sue C. He can sue A and B, he can B, sue B and C, he can sue C and A. Or he can sue all of them, A, B, C. So, the other partner, partner who's getting sued cannot say that, look, only you are suing me, why don't you sue the other partners? That is not possible. Okay. So, he has every right to sue either all the partners together or each or some of the partners. That this is called joint and several. Joint means all of them are liable. Several means each one is liable. Okay. Supposing one of the partners is a very rich partner, people will prefer suing him and collecting the money first. But having paid the money first, he can sue the other partners and get the proportionate share from them. This is called unlimited liability. And the last characteristic of partnership is principal agency relationship. What is principal agency relationship? See, I have to explain to you who is the principal, who's an agent and what is the principal agency relationship. In case of principal is normally the owner of a property. Agent is a person appointed by the principal to carry on certain activities. Let us assume a person, particular person has got lots of properties. He would like to sell off these properties and invest at some other place. So, because these are the properties which he has acquired it long back. Now, he feels it is worthwhile selling of these properties and then buy some more property at some other place which are likely to grow in future. So, there are a lot of properties to be sold off. You don't expect the owner of a particular person who is the owner of the property who has got lots of properties in different locations. Different types of properties, houses, lands, agricultural land, residential land, commercial land, to interact with each of the prospective buyers. What he will do is, he will appoint another person who's called his agent. The agent will do the work of coordinating with various persons, taking them to the various places, permitting them to inspect the site, give various property documents, Xerox copies of the documents, so that prospective buyer goes through and satisfy himself that the property is legally, it has no problems, this property can be purchased. He also quotes the price. So, he interacts with a number of parties. Ultimately, one of them is going to buy. So, what he does is, he does this work, the property is not his, the property is the principal's. Agent is doing the work. In case of a partnership firm, all the partners are both principal as well as agent. To give you an example, when a particular partner represents the firm in front of some other authority, he is the agent. All other partners, the rest of the partners are principal. For example, let us assume there are three partners in a firm, A, B, C. A is an expert as far as the marketing of product is concerned. B is an expert as far as the sourcing of materials is concerned, purchases are concerned. And C is an expert dealing with banks, getting funds for the operations, etc. Now what happens is, A goes and meets a prospective customer. The customer wants the material in bulk. He agrees to supply the goods in bulk. Because the prospective customer is likely to buy the goods in bulk, he is demanding a better price, a lower price. Transportation, it has got to be delivered at his factory. And he also wants a longer credit period. So he agrees to many of these things. He says, yes, I'm prepared to give you a longer credit period. I'm prepared to supply you at a cheaper rate. He agrees on the pricing, etc. Then he is the... He is the agent. He is the agent because he is representing the other two partners. Whatever commitments he gives, He is the agent because whatever commitments he gives regarding the price, lower than the price at which the business sells to other parties, he is binding on the other partners. He gives you a longer credit period. Normally the firm is not at all giving credit to anybody. But to this person, to agree to give 15 days credit because he is going to buy in bulk. The normal customer buys goods for 400 rupees, 500 rupees. This chap is going to buy for 50,000 rupees. So you agree to give him credit for 15 days. So these are binding on the principal, the other two partners. Similarly, when the partner B, when he goes and agrees on the sourcing of material, he might agree that yes, that the other person, that he firm would be in a position to make the payment within 7 days. It will be able to make the payment within 7 days, but it has got to get the discount, discount of 3%, 2%, like that. So he agrees on that. It is binding on the other partners. The person who goes to the bank for organizing the loan, he agrees on the rate of interest, what is the security to be given, what all the various charges, processing fee, what is the quantum of overdraft that the bank is prepared to give. All these things he agrees upon. He is the agent. The other partners are the principal. So every partner is both the principal as well as the agent, as far as the partnership firm is concerned. These are the characteristics of a partnership firm. But you do not have to know any of these things if you want to know the basic of accounts as far as the partnership firm is concerned. So, there is absolutely, as far as principle is concerned, there is absolutely no difference in the principles governing the maintenance of accounts as far as the sole proprietor is concerned and principles for maintenance of accounts for a partnership firm is concerned. The same three rules applicable for personal accounts, debit the receiver, credit the giver. For real accounts, debit what all comes in, credit what all goes out. For nominal account, credit all in losses and expenses and credit all incomes and gains. Same rules are applicable for a partnership firm also. But there is a small difference. In case of a sole proprietor, you would use the terminology capital. Here there are three persons who are putting in capital into the business. So you have to be very specific. You have to say X is capital account, Y is capital account, or Z is capital account. Similarly, drawings. You have to say X drawings, Y is drawings, Z is drawings. These are the things. So Then what happens in case of a partnership firm? Partnership firm prepares both profit and loss account and profit and loss appropriation account. What is the difference between the profit and loss account and profit and loss appropriation account? Profit and loss account is prepared by all businesses. It ultimately gives you whether the firm has made a profit during a particular accounting year or has incurred a loss, and whatever is the profit or loss, the quantum of profit or loss. This is given by a profit and loss account. That will be the last item, which is the net profit. Okay. The first item on the credit side is the gross profit. So a profit and loss account starts with gross profit on the credit side, which is the right hand side of the profit and loss account. And last item is net profit. If the firm has incurred a loss, it will come on the right side by net loss. Okay, this is a typical profit and loss account. It is to be prepared. All expenses which are genuinely incurred for the purpose of earning the revenues are debited to profit and loss account, like salary, rent, repairs, printing and stationery. All these things are debited to depreciation, interest. These are debited to profit and loss account. On the credit side, gross profit will be there. If you have any other income like discount received, commission received, rent received, interest received, it comes in. And ultimately, you arrive at the net profit. Okay. In case of a partnership firm, a partner is entitled to certain payouts from the firm. For example, a partner might be entitled to salary. He is entitled to get salary because he works for the firm. He is entitled to salary. The partners might be entitled to interest on capital. They might be entitled to commission, some commission. So, these are the entitlements of the partner. Similarly, they may be liable to pay interest on drawings. See, capital is the amount contributed by the partner and received by the firm. Whereas drawings is the amount which are taken out of the firm by the partner. In case of a capital, the person who receives it is the firm, the person who gives it is the partner. So, if there is an interest on capital, capital is to be paid by the person who received the capital, namely the firm. And it is to be paid to the person who gave this capital, namely the partner. In case, if there is an interest on drawings, it is to be received by the firm and paid by the partner. Because the partner is taking out money, if he has to pay interest on it, he has to make the payment and firm will receive the money. That is why interest on drawings is an income to the firm. It is shown on the credit side. Okay, what is the profit and loss appropriation account? Once you make a profit, you decide how this profit is going to be allocated to various partners. So, profit and loss appropriation account you prepare after the net profit is arrived at. And it starts off on the right hand side by net profit. Whatever net profit you arrived at the in the profit and loss account becomes the first item in the profit and loss appropriation account. That is the amount available for appropriation, for giving it in a particular share to various partners. So, then you have a look at the partnership deed. How much salary to be paid to each of the partners. Certain partners might be entitled to salary, certain partners may not be entitled to the salary. All the partners might be entitled to salary, but the amount could be different for each partner. So, you first give salary to the partners. You give then interest on capital to the partner. If a partner looks after any sales and if he is entitled to commission, you give such commission also to the partner. On the credit side, if a partner has withdrawn some money from the business and he is to pay interest to the firm as interest on drawings, put it on the credit side because it's an income to the firm, you put it on the credit side by interest on drawings. So, on the credit side, there can be only two items. Net profit will be there by net profit and by interest on drawings. On the debit side, all the expenses which are payable to the partners will be there, like interest on capital, salaries, commission, and the balance amount needs to be apportioned in the profit sharing ratio. As I told you already, if the profit sharing ratio has been agreed upon, it should be in that profit sharing ratio, or if nothing is agreed upon, it is equally. If the partnership deed is silent, a partner is not entitled to salary, he is not entitled to commission, he is not entitled to interest on capital, and he is not liable to pay interest on drawings. Okay, so this is the difference between profit and loss account and profit and loss appropriation account. Appropriation account does not give you the profit. Appropriation account gives you only the division of profit amongst the partners in a particular way. Whereas profit and loss account gives you what is the profit. Profit consists of sales minus all the expenses, and then you arrive at a profit. Profit and loss account starts with gross profit, ends with net profit. Profit and loss appropriation starts with net profit and ends with the allocating the residual profit to various partners in the profit sharing ratio. Okay. So there can be problems on this. How do you allocate the profits to the partners, which we can have a look at it. The next is the admission of a partner. I am going into what is known as admission of a partner. What is admission of a partner? See, what happens is, when the business is growing, it requires more funds. The business might be growing very fast, so you require more funds. So the existing partners themselves put in some additional capital. Whatever profit the firm is making, they are not withdrawing the whole profit but leaving the money to be in the business so that the business can grow and make more profits in the years to come. They go to the bank, borrow some money. They borrow money from some private sources. They discuss with the people who supply goods to them and request for a higher credit period. These are the things they do to manage the fund situation. But even beyond this, you feel the business is growing, it is better if one more person comes in, if he puts in his capital, more money will be available, then we can grow faster, etc. Then you decide to take one more partner. That partner is called an incoming partner. Okay, an incoming partner no doubt has to bring in capital. That capital will be determined amongst the partners, the existing partner as well as the new partner he is going to come in. But he is also to bring in one other amount called amount towards goodwill. What is goodwill? What is goodwill? Goodwill is the reputation that this business is enjoying in the market. See, when the old partner started the business, there was no certainty that the business will become profitable. The business will make a profit. See, in a business, you can make profit, you can also incur a loss. It is just like two sides of a coin. One side is a head, the other side is a tail. Similarly, in case of a partnership firm, one side is a profit, the other side is a loss. Every person wants to make a profit in a business, but not all of them are very lucky. Some of them incur losses also. But now, around the time when the new partner wants to come in, the business has stabilized totally. Business is making good profit. There is a certainty that this profit will come in future years also. So this is the advantage the new partner is getting. He comes in at a time when there is reasonable certainty that the business will make profits in the years to come. Otherwise, the existing partner will not take in a new partner. New partner will not agree to come in. Second thing is, because a new partner is coming in, the proportion of the profit sharing ratio of the existing partners, it comes down. See, this particular thing requires some explanation. See, it is very, very simple. Let us assume now, as on date, there are four partners. They are sharing the profits and losses equally. If a profit of 1 lakh of rupees is made in the business, and assuming they are sharing the profits and losses equally, each partner will get 25,000 rupees. That is today's situation. After the new partner comes in, let us for the sake of simplicity assume the new partner also comes in as an equal partner. So now there, instead of four partners, now there are five partners. They are sharing profits and losses equally. Now what happens is, assuming next year after the new partner comes in, still the profit remains at 1 lakh of rupees. Each partner will get not 25,000 rupees, but only 20,000 rupees. Because previously the profit was shared amongst four persons. Now the profit is being shared amongst five persons. So because of that, the existing partners are sacrificing a part of the profit to which they were entitled to before the new person became a partner. They were getting previously 25,000 rupees. Now they are going to get only 20,000 rupees. That 5,000 rupees is the sacrifice that that person is making. But then the question arises, can I stop? Okay, thank you very much.